Welcome to Successful Roadside Revegetation Using Native Plants. We're glad you could join us. What you are seeing as we drive along this scenic roadway is one example of several successful roadside revegetation projects constructed by the Federal Highway Administration. Roadside revegetation is not a topic most people think about as they drive through the scenic landscapes of our beautiful public lands. But it's surprising to learn how much this landscape has changed since the completion of the road construction. The healthy and sustainable natural environment you see here now looks like it's always been this way, but it's actually the result of careful planning, well-coordinated teamwork, and very advanced applied science. Roadside revegetation using native plants has proven to be an essential part of road construction. In this video, you will meet a dedicated group of experts who will describe the benefits of roadside revegetation, which is both art and science. Some of the many benefits include: the careful selection and placement of native plants enhances visibility for drivers and keeps wildlife away from roadsides. A strong community of locally adapted native plants will develop a root system that helps stabilize roadside slopes. This further enhances road safety, while also protecting nearby waterways from the erosion that would occur if the slopes were unprotected. While not always the least expensive option, roadside revegetation using native plants often offers lower transportation and energy costs for implementation. This leads to fewer carbon emissions and other environmental burdens. When non-native plants are used in roadside revegetation, problems such as weeds and plant failure can increase the long-term costs of roadside maintenance, offsetting any savings that were initially realized. Installing native plants typically reduces the overall long-term road maintenance costs and increases the likelihood of early success. Many visitors to public lands enjoy the journey to their destination as much as the destination itself. Revegetating roadsides with native plants greatly adds to the area's natural beauty and the visitor's overall experience. One of the Federal Highway Administration's vital few goals is environmental stewardship. Roadside revegetation using native plants promotes this goal by helping to establish natural, healthy, and sustainable roadside plant communities. Finally, the principles of roadside revegetation using native plants have been implemented and refined in many climates and locations over many years, and the results are clear. These principles work. Efforts to revegetate roadsides after road construction are not new. But early efforts were often uncoordinated, and they over-relied on attractive but non-native species, which usually created more problems than they solved. In the 1980s, the Federal Highway Administration began a series of initiatives to dramatically improve the success rate of revegetation programs. By partnering with the National Park Service on key projects in Glacier National Park and at Lake Mead National Recreation Area, the path to a new, more sustainable approach to roadside revegetation using native plants was established.
The first revegetation project that we worked on was the 303B piece, which is along the Lake McDonald corridor of the Going to the Sun. And we started planting in 1987, and I believe started planting in 1989. I would say 1990 it was completed, and we have been monitoring it since then. Initially it was monitored every year, then every 3 years, 5 years, and I think we're now on a 10-year cycle. The resources that we have available to us in the park are funding from the Federal Highway. It is a great program to work with in that we do have lead time and funding provided to give us time to collect the plant material that we need. We partner with Natural Resources Conservation Service to increase our seed, give us technical advice, and then just an amazing staff of seasonal folks and leaders who help us implement the work here. When we're doing restoration, we're trying to recreate habitat, and one of our goals is actually to blend into the adjacent undisturbed. And so to do that, we have to have a variety of life forms, including our forbs or wildflowers, the grasses, the carexes, the shrubs, and as well as the conifer and deciduous trees. So we really try and capture all of those life forms in our plantings. We look to colonizer species, but also we grow a lot of trees and other life forms so that when we implement a restoration project, we can blend into the adjacent undisturbed vegetation.
We found that throughout the entire process of the Lakeshore Road project that from phase to phase, the FHWA was extremely helpful, very amenable to changes that we wanted to make in our restoration procedures and methods throughout the entire thing from phase to phase. We'd make small changes, they would be very supportive of that. They also thoroughly understood that we were experimenting here. We were doing things that we had never done before, or that not quite making it up as we went along, but we were using the best knowledge that we had to try things that had never really been done before. Most of the time it turned out very successful.
The path to current revegetation techniques was advanced further in the 1990s when the Federal Highway Administration teamed with the United States Forest Service.
In the mid-1990s, the U.S. Forest Service and the Federal Highway Administration partnered to form a team of revegetation specialists that would work throughout the Pacific Northwest. I wanted to see the Forest Service more in charge of its revegetation destiny. I wanted to see the agency use only locally adapted native plant materials. And I also wanted to pioneer new strategies to use those plant materials more wisely.
The success of these initial projects proved that this new area of expertise was on the right track. And other federal organizations, such as the Bureau of Land Management, United States Fish and Wildlife Service, and the Bureau of Indian Affairs, further advanced the efforts by offering their support and resources. These years of multi-agency cooperation, research, and trial and error have resulted in universally accepted practices for roadside revegetation using native plants and context-sensitive design, which can be implemented effectively by different agencies in different locations. Some of these techniques include bucket imprinting, hydroseeding, mulching, composting, seed collection and extraction, and vegetated walls. Details on these techniques and other important revegetation topics can be found in two important and widely used resources: the Roadside Revegetation Manual, which is a comprehensive guide covering all aspects of roadside revegetation using native plants, and the nativerevegetation.org website, which includes the complete roadside revegetation manual, as well as in-depth training and interactive visualization to help the user learn about and observe results of the revegetation project lifecycle. The revegetation project lifecycle is a detailed protocol that runs concurrently with the road construction project. It consists of six steps: initiation, planning, implementation, monitoring and management, adapting and improving, and initiation of future projects. An important aspect of this life cycle is that every revegetation project serves as a resource and knowledge base of best practices for future projects, making revegetation with native plants an ever-evolving and improving process. To date, hundreds of projects nationwide have successfully used the revegetation project lifecycle.
So the new approach basically integrates throughout the entire process the revegetation with the design and through construction, and then we take what we learn from our monitoring and put it into the next project. I wanted to develop a strategy so that we were working together 2 to 3 years before we broke ground on a project, so that we were involved at the planning stage, through the development stage, through the construction stage, and ultimately be able to spend 3 to 4 years monitoring the project after it was completed.
This project has been a success because there has been a very strong partnership between our regional office, which has a lot of landscape expertise, and our Essex residency, which has a lot of very skillful and dedicated frontline maintenance workers. We're able to develop a plan and put it into place relatively easily. We're using native vegetation in this, partly because we want to work with what is on site and what is native to the Adirondacks, and partly because there's requirements that we use native plants. We have a special program in New York State Department of Transportation called Green and Blue Highways. It's an environmental stewardship initiative where maintenance forces can identify projects of environmental significance and do them with their own forces or with a little bit of extra money from the main office of New York State DOT. Our people in our regional office, our landscape people, came up with a planting plan for vegetation that would be appropriate for this location to help stabilize the soil and to be native vegetation consistent with the location.
I think that the success overall of this project was in working in a collaborative way on the project with the regulatory and permitting people, as well as with the contractor, and able to develop a design that took a little extra effort, was somewhat innovative. It's maybe not the usual way to do a project, but we don't really have a lot of projects where you are impacting so closely the edge of a river along a major state highway. So everybody kind of pitched in, and I think that it was that collaborative effort that really helped in supporting the project. And maybe we got a little lucky with the weather, that we had some good rains after the things were planted. I think we had a pretty responsive contractor, both the general contractor and the landscape contractor. And it's really nice to come back here after 5 years and be able to see these plants flourishing along the, you know, the banks of the Deerfield River.
I'm a project manager for several projects, so I oversee from the beginning, the planning stages, all the way through implementation, through monitoring. Some of these projects can go 7 to 8 years in length. Several years back, I contracted seed collection to a local botanist who went around this area and picked seed of the species we wanted to use on the project. And we did two things with that seed. The grass seed, we actually had a contract farmer grow out several hundred pounds of it in his fields. And then he sent us clean grass seed. And the second bunch of seed we sent to a Forest Service nursery to grow into seedlings. And after a year, they sent us the seedlings to plant here on the site. Well, we're watching them blow the compost on this hillside here. And in the compost, there's some seed that gets mixed in at the same time. And this is a seed that we had the grower grow out in large amounts. And in the next few months, it's going to get some showers. And it'll probably grow into small plants in the next 2 or 3 months. The MSC walls were constructed by a road contractor. He brought in topsoil, put about a foot of topsoil in the front with some grass mats. These were mats that had seed on it. And then we came in the fall and we planted them with seedlings. When you begin to implement these projects, a lot of it rests on your relationship with the project engineer, the person who actually builds the road and oversees the road. In the case of this project, Chuck Mikola was great to work with. We really tried to keep the footprint of this project really small, so we didn't have to do a lot of revegetation. So part of revegetation is just trying to keep, don't make a lot of mess so you don't have to clean it up. And Chuck did a great job of that.
On the Blaine project, I'd say we started out successfully by recognizing that we had some environmental issues, and we brought in the environmental resource agencies, including the contractors, sit around the table and try to understand what each vision was. Everyone has a vision on that project and wanted to make sure that that vision was common amongst everyone. And in that process, the contractor also recognized that there were some issues to be dealt with, and those were resolved in that initial meeting.
And then finally, the last phase of this thing is we monitor it. And that's a really important piece, and we kind of drop it. A lot of our projects, most of us drop it just the way we do things. We move on to the next project. But we really feel strongly that we need to be monitoring, because that's our loop back. Did we do what we said we were going to do, you know? Did we? And what did we learn from it? There's so much we can learn from it that we can take to the next project. I think the main success of this project was the collaboration we had between so many different groups here. The environmentalist specialists out of the Vancouver Federal Highway Office, collaboration I had within the Forest Service, collaboration with our contractors.
I think the success of this project can be easily measured by one issue, and that is the sounding board of the public being very satisfied and making comments. What a nice job we've done.
In 2006, we did a pavement preservation project where we took out all the old pavement, put in new, changed a lot of culverts, changed pullouts and parking areas, and had a really successful restoration program. Well, from the very beginning, we're very concerned about the visitor experience and driving the road. It's an 8-mile loop road with another mile of a two-way section that goes out to a picnic area. So once you get started on the loop road, you have to go all the way around, which is kind of interesting for both restoration purposes and construction purposes as well. I think some of the good points in this project were the collaboration we had from the very beginning in the design work, what would need to be salvaged, the time frame that we needed to collect seed, to propagate plants, to salvage the plants that we wanted to salvage, and then working with the contractor and the park staff to make sure that the sites were prepared correctly so that we could replant them. I think the other thing is knowing restoration techniques that work in your particular environment. The Sonoran Desert is difficult to restore, but because of its two rainy seasons, there are some advantages. And we had about 5 years experience in doing restoration work in similar kinds of sites, and were able to put those lessons to practice as we did this larger road project.
The Guanella Pass Scenic Byway in Colorado passes through two U.S. forest districts and includes a vertical climb of over 3,000 feet from the base to the pass. One challenge to the project was the extreme climate changes throughout the year. The revegetation team for the road redesign project had to collect and develop three separate seed mixes, one for each of three different plant zones at different elevations along the roadway. The team only utilized plant species which naturally occur in these climate zones. The upper stretches of the roadway, over 11,000 feet in elevation, were home to alpine tundra, which was salvaged in sections and replaced along the roadway after construction to maintain these fragile native species.
There was no introduction of other trees, seed, or shrubs that weren't naturally occurring, so the seed mix that we put onto those exposed slopes that we hadn't touched introduces the natural species that was here and allows that growth to occur. We pretty much want to build the roadway and show that we didn't touch anything else. That's the overall goal.
Gonzales Pass is a 9-mile project on the Tonto National Forest, and my role is I serve as an ADOT liaison on projects like Gonzales Pass. This project produced a unique challenge in that the Land Management Agency has the responsibility for stewardship of the resources, whereas the Transportation Agency has the responsibility to build a new highway, a safer highway. And in that process, there are risks that have to be taken by both agencies. And I think the key to this whole process working was in people developing good relationships across those agency boundaries, developing trust to be able to trust each other when some of these risks have to be taken. And the outcome invariably is better.
It was discovered early on that the transfer of knowledge and resources was essential for the development of an effective revegetation program. In 2009 and 2010, to help identify innovative techniques that warrant inclusion in a national program, the Federal Highway Administration conducted an in-depth internet and on-site survey, known as a SCAN survey, that included experts from federal and state agencies and from diverse geographic locations. By providing a panel of experts with the opportunity to travel to several regions throughout the United States to interact with local revegetation specialists and observe their in-progress revegetation projects firsthand, the SCAN survey process helped identify emerging trends and consolidate the best practices of the science. The Revegetation SCAN survey provided a dynamic and vital forum that will help advance the momentum of revegetation programs nationwide. Through collaboration, applied science, and the application of lessons learned, a proven process of revegetation using native plants is firmly established and is promoting the concept of resource stewardship that benefits both road projects and those using the roads.
I think the foundation of any partnership is that both agencies, or all agencies involved, share risks together, and they share in the successes and they share in the failures. And this partnership has proven to be incredibly successful. And I think the biggest reason is we have a shared vision of what we both sides want to see out on the project.
Roadside revegetation using native plants has come a long way in a few short years. From its humble beginnings as a road project afterthought, the dedication of people in multiple agencies and scientific disciplines have advanced it into a mature, replicable process which can be employed by any agency that manages road projects. The art and science of roadside revegetation will ensure that in the years ahead, we can all look forward to a better, safer visitor experience and greener, more sustainable roadways.